Notice.
In accordance with Section 5 of the Open Public Meetings Act, be advised that notice of this meeting was made by posting on a bulletin board in Town Hall and mailing to the officially designated newspapers a list of the meeting dates annually, indicating that this meeting would take place on Monday, October 19th, 2020 at 7 p.m. Due to the COVID-19 virus and mandatory quarantines imposed under executive orders by Governor Philip Murphy, Millburn Town Hall is closed to the public for the purpose of board meetings. A supplemental notice was given in addition to the annual notice due to the transformation of this meeting into a remote virtual meeting. The supplemental notice contained information necessary for members of the public to attend the meeting through the Zoom platform, both by audio and or video means. The public will have the same opportunity to participate at the appropriate time virtually, just as if they were attending an in-person meeting. The supplemental notice was posted on the Millburn Township website, Millburn Town Hall bulletin board, and Millburn Town Hall front door. Supplemental notice was also forwarded to the official newspapers, submitted to the township clerk, and published in the item on October 15th, 2020.
Very good. Thank you.
Craig Plattner?
Here.
Jody Sharma?
Here.
Joy Siegel?
Here.
Steve Toger?
Here.
Wolfgang Tatoris?
Here.
Kevin Wenzel?
Here.
Vice Chairwoman Jessica Glatt?
Here.
Chairman Joseph Steinberg?
Here. Okay, we have minutes tonight?
No minutes.
Okay, so we're going to go to the memorialization. I'm seeing on the agenda the Bressler memorialization, correct?
And COCA.
Pardon me?
And the COCA.
COCA's not on the written agenda, but it's also available.
But it is available?
Yes, and she has the roll call sheet on that one.
Okay. So let's do Bressler first. Are there any additions or corrections to the proposed memorialization in calendar number 3755-20, Elisa and Andrew Bressler? I hear none.
I do. I don't know. Mr. Delaney keeps raising and putting his hand down, so I don't know if he has. I don't know if he has a question. Hold on. No, I lost him. Right, now his hand is down. Now it's up. I don't know. All right. Well, let me allow him to talk and let me see. He has to stop raising his hand because it keeps moving him every time he does that. I can't. There we go.
Jay Delaney, on behalf of Ms. Kogan, just wanted to enter an appearance that I was here, that I also, as a matter of courtesy, sent the resolution. And by the way, thank you, Ms. Davitt, for sending it to me. I sent it to Gary Hall, so he has received it. I just wanted to make sure Gary Hall's name of his client was spelled correctly. I wasn't sure. I don't really care. And I want to enter an appearance that at least I'm here while it's being memorialized. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Nicole? Your name, Nicole's name came up on my screen.
I don't know why. Well, she's in the gallery, so.
I'm here, but I didn't say anything.
You're talking.
You didn't say anything? Okay. Mr. Delaney, thank you very much. Are there any additions or corrections to the Bressler memorialization? If not, is there a motion from someone who was at the meeting?
Yeah, eligible to vote on this are Craig Plattner, Jody Sharma, Joyce Siegel, Wolfgang Tutoris, Jessica Glatt, Joseph Steinberg.
Will one of those make a motion to adopt the memorializing resolution?
So moves.
Second.
Craig Plattner?
Yes.
Jody Jody Sharma?
Yes.
Joy Siegel?
Yes.
Wolfgang Tutoris?
Yes.
Jessica Glatt?
Yes.
Joseph Steinberg?
Yes. All right, the next memorialization that is not on the agenda, but it is available tonight and it has been circulated, is COKA, K-O-K-A, calendar number 3757-20. Are there any additions or corrections to the COKA memorializing resolution? Will someone make a motion to adopt it? Who's eligible?
I'm sorry.
Eileen?
Jody, Joy, Steve, Jessica, Joe.
Will one of those individuals like to make a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Craig Plettner?
Yes.
Jody Sharma?
Yes.
Joy Siegel?
Yes.
Steve Toger?
Yes.
Jessica Glatt?
Yes.
Joseph Steinberg?
Yes. All right, that takes care of the memorializations. And thank you to our attorney for preparing them. And thank you to our subcommittee for going over the memorializing resolutions. Has Mary joined us?
No. No.
Okay, we have one application on for tonight, which is New Jersey Energy. We've heard this case twice before, Eileen.
Oh,
more than twice.
Yeah, one, two, three. Yeah, yeah. This is probably our fifth hearing.
Fifth?
Yes. Twice, the second one since we've gone virtual. So I brought back over, and Mr. Posada, is there anyone else from your, that I need to bring over?
Yes, I keep bringing over Kamal Shah. He is our architect, and also Jack Carman, who's our landscape architect.
Got it.
And available to the audience is Scott Parker, who's a representative of NJ Energy Corp.
Do you want him to speak over as well?
I'm being recusing myself.
And you're recusing.
Right. You can leave, Wolfgang.
Good night. Did Scott Parker, do you want me to bring him over?
No need, not at this moment, thank you.
Okay. And Mr. Delaney, who we know is for the objector, do you want me to bring him over, Gail, as well, or?
Sure, of course. Yeah.
Mr. Posada, do you have a witness ready to go here?
Yes, I do. I would like to call my first witness, Kamal Shah. He is the one who prepared the architectural plans in connection with this application.
Okay, Mr. Shah, if you would just raise your right hand, please. Do you swear from the testimony you're about to give in tonight's Zoom hearing to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
If you just state your name for the record, spelling your name, please.
First name is Kamlesh, K-A-M-L.
You're going to have to speak up, sir. Okay. Raise your volume.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Not really well, but we can hear you.
Not well.
I guess, well, I'll stay a little bit closer to my computer. Hopefully I can speak loudly. First name is Kamlesh, K-A-M-L-E-S-H. Last name is Shah, S-H-A-H. Workplace is 1 Liberty Way in Cranberry, New Jersey. That's my ID. And if you want my qualification, I can go do that as well.
Yes, we do want them.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm a licensed architect. Again, businesses in Cranberry. I have licenses in the state of New Jersey, New York, Maryland. Have practiced my own practice for the last 22 years. work experience last 37 years, and I have represented several cases in over 100 townships in New Jersey and some in New York.
Can you just name a couple municipalities where you've been qualified as an expert in architecture?
We've done Princeton, West Windsor, Ridgewood, Bridgewater.
And is your license still in good standing?
Yes, sir.
Board Chair, I propose him as an expert witness in architecture.
He's so accepted.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Thomas, did you visit the subject property?
Yes, I did.
And are you familiar with the OR2 zone district?
Yes, sir.
And are you also familiar with the subject properties within the zone district?
That's correct, yes.
And are you also familiar with the township's master plan?
Yes.
When drafting architectural plans, did you take into consideration the zoning ordinances for the OR2 and also the master plan?
We did.
Terrific. Now, can you please explain to the board the proposed architecturals?
Yes, I'm pretty sure the exhibits were provided. I have three plans. One is SK1, which is the exterior elevations, SK2, which is the exterior elevations again, and SK3, which is a floor plan. I will speak to the floor plan first.
And they all have the date November 15, 2018, correct?
Correct. All three of them are dated November 15, 2018. And the plan is obviously the shape of the property is a little bit odd shape. And it was a little bit of a challenge to lay out the building. It is a convenience store, a very small convenience store, approximately 1,800 square feet. The convenience store, it would have no cooking in the space. It will pre-packed packages other than coffee, some hot dogs, and some knickknacks, candies, and things of that nature. They would have drinks, cold drinks. The interior would have a reach-in refrigerator so people can grab their drinks and leave, some snacks, and a front counter where you can pay and also have some hot dogs. The interiors, we do have a prep area on the backside of the cash counter. We have one handicap accessible bathroom, and the facility will be fully handicapped accessible. That is our floor plan. The floor plan also identifies the real windows, and I will speak to it on the elevation sheets. We have real windows on the front of the building, which is facing the canopy. The rear of the building, which basically faces the corner of Vauxhall and Millburn, and we have real windows there as well. And on the two sides, Vauxhall Road and Millburn, those are faux windows, which is not real windows. It's just the windows are on the exterior and they're blocked from the inside just because it is, if one falls in the back of the reach-in refrigerator and the other one falls in the service area. I would move on to the other sheet. Give me one second.
When it comes to the interior plans, just to clarify, there are no proposed tables or seating arrangements for the public, correct?
That's correct.
Thank you.
The second sheet is SK1. SK1 dated November 15, 2018. What it does show, there are three elevations. The front elevation facing the canopy, which is the top left-hand corner, which identifies the exterior facade of the building. The building, as you can see, is a residential scale, small building with the building height to the top of the mansard roof is about 20 feet. And the front of the building, we have, as a matter of fact, all four sides of the building, we are proposing brick facade with two colors, one at the dark brick at the bottom, light brick above it, with a wood plank band all around four sides, and the roof is asphalt roofing consistent with residential materials. The windows are residential style, a little bit larger, but the material is glass with wood frame and muntins on the transom on the top. You could see it on all four elevations that were identified. We are proposing muntins to bring in the residential feature into this facade. The signage.
When you were designing the facade for the proposed improvement, did you look at the surrounding neighborhood to try to match for consistency?
Yes, we did. We did. As a matter of fact, the material that we specified is consistent with some of the residences that are across the road, Millburn Avenue, and also a little bit on the east side of this property, there's a commercial building that also has brick facade. So we did not want to design something with material that would be foreign to the area. One additional information that I did not mention, that this is in a flood zone, and the building that we're proposing here is a dry building. A dry building being that the water would be allowed to pass through underneath the building. And as you see on my elevation number 2 and elevation number 3 on that sheet SK1, we are proposing open structure underneath the building, which would allow the water to pass through and not create a pressure on the facade, and also will not allow water inside the building. The signage that we are identifying on the building, they're not lit, meaning they're not internally lit. They are on a wood plank with carved letters. And the convenience store we're identifying this as Chestnut Mart, which is a franchise retail facility our client has. So there are three elevations shown on this sheet. If you look at the Vaux Hill Road facade, which is number 2, that does not, it's a faux window. Basically, that's not real. It's glass and a wood window, but the backside is blocked and there is no light coming through it. The elevation number 3, it's the same way, that it does not have real windows, meaning it does not, the light does not transmit through either inside or outside. It's basically a facade that is windows, but the backside is blocked. I will go to SK2, which has only one elevation, and that is corner.
Yes. Gail, I have had a request from someone who is attending that if Mr. Shaw could perhaps share his screen while he's speaking about the plans.
I can probably do that if...
I don't know if that's...
Okay. Can you see it?
Yeah, perfect. I think that'll help. Thank you.
All right. So I just flashed the other ones quickly. This was a floor plan that we talked about. The front elevation, the Vauxhall Road elevation, I mean the side, the corner of both Millburn and Vauxhall, and then the parallel to Millburn is where both this window and the window on Vauxhall, they are full windows, not through. And if you could see, it's basically blocked in the back side. The back corner of Vauxhall and Millburn, this is a real window and the front is a real window. The right side is basically utility area, and the left side is the walk-in refrigerator with handicap bathroom, gondolas, coffee station, and the front counter with cash registers and also some hot dogs. If we go back to elevation sheet number 1, Again, it's SK1, November 15th, three elevations. Elevation number one is the front elevation. Elevation number two is Vauxhall Road elevation. This window that we're talking about is, again, a fake window. And elevation number three is, it's basically a weird angle. As you could see, the plan is about five-sided, realistically. And what I was talking about, dry flood building, is because we have these columns, we call them stilts, raised, and the water will pass through underneath this. That's why we've created the bottom as an open area.
Not a common practice.
It is. You could either do wet buildings or dry building, and it all depends on the choice of the client. And I guess the bottom line is, if we do wet, then there's a lot of damage of the inventory that the users will face, or the client will face. And if it's dry, you are basically avoiding water coming into the building. So in this case, we chose to make it dry. SK2, November 15, 2018. Again, this elevation is the corner of Millburn and Vauxhall Road. And again, is what we're saying is, it's a residential scale building with materials consistent with the residence and one property, or almost the neighboring property on the east side of the project. It is a brick as well. So we are, in this case, proposing bricks on all five sides, as we said, and because it's exposed on most all of the directions of the property. I believe that's about all I have as far as my testimony.
I have no further questions for this witness.
I do have a question for Mr. Shah. Can we take the sharing down? Okay, I do have a question for Mr. Shah. From the front of the building to I'm looking at the drawing number, I guess, plan number one on the first page of the drawing. And I'm seeing there's a rectangle drawn in the middle of the property. Is that the proposed gas pumps?
You know what? Just hold on one second. I need to get my drawings back so I could look at them. Okay, I'm having difficulty doing that, but go ahead and ask the question again, if you don't mind, please.
Yes, again, I'm looking at drawing number, I guess it's number four on the first page of the plans. And I'm looking at the front of the building, the proposed building, showing, I think, 61 feet across the front.
Right.
And there's a little triangle with a circle through it, just to the, I guess, to the south of the building. I don't know what that is. Can you tell me?
I believe that's my elevation tag mark. It is just the tag that identifies which side elevation shows up where.
Okay, now beneath that is a rectangle. Do you see it?
You know, just give me one second. I will pull up my drawings on the other screen. that I can't for some reason get that out of here.
This is key plan number 4.
Yeah, give me 1 second.
Good. I mean, he's reducing the building.
It lines up with the canopy. If you look at the site plan from Walls Engineering, it seems that rectangle is, I believe, the canopy area.
Well, that's what I'm asking the witness, if he knows.
Oh, that probably is the line for the gas canopy, which is not, we're not showing as part of our elevation or part of our building.
Well, that's not part of the building, I understand. Do you happen to know how far, what the distance is between the front of the building and that rectangle, the nearest part of the rectangle to the building? Do you happen to know that distance?
Unfortunately, I do not know that distance.
Okay, that's fine. I have no other questions as this witness. I'm sorry, one more question. How many square feet did you say the building was?
1,820, to be specific.
Thank you. Any other questions of this witness?
Mr. Chairman, a member of the public has, I thought she, there was a member of the public with questions.
Are you saying that there is a member of the public?
Yes, Judith Rosenthal.
Yes, Mrs. Rosenthal.
She's on mute.
Yeah, unmute herself. There she goes.
Okay. Since you raised the nature of the items that were going to be sold, does that include rolling papers?
That's outside of the scope of his.
Yes, no, it's not. He opened the door by describing what was going to be sold. And this is an item of high interest to the residents of Millburn Township. We want to know what kind of goods are going to be sold, and ergo, what kind of people are going to be frequenting this grocery store. We have every right to know. And how dare you question a member of the public on a matter of such public importance, especially when your witness opened the door to that.
Well, I just...
Mr. Posada, if this witness does not know the answer, then perhaps you can put somebody on.
I'm going to object. You're coaching the witness. You are coaching him, essentially telling him what to say.
Ms. Rosenthal,
improper.
Ms. Rosenthal, I'm just suggesting if he doesn't know the answer...
Yes, exactly. You're telling him what to say. Come on. Stop with the gamesmanship. We are members of the public, and you are.
I understand that, Ms. Rosenthal.
You, Ms. Frazier, you are obstructing the public's right to know on a matter of high public importance. We all know, anyone who's a lawyer in this crowd knows exactly what kind of shenanigans you're pulling. And I think you're paid by the taxpayers, and I think that you should stop this nonsense. Allow the witness to answer and stop coaching him through your objections.
I will quickly mention. Go ahead, Matt.
I believe Ms. Frazier just identified that I have another witness who could better answer your question. Now we will answer it, but I have another witness who could answer it and answer any and all other questions that might be related to operations.
If that's the case, that's fine. And I'll withdraw my question and ask it of the appropriate witness. Thank you, Counselor.
Do you have any other questions?
Are there any other questions for this witness?
Mr. Chair, I have questions, but I always defer to the public first.
Eileen, is there anyone else in the public who has a question?
No, there are no other hands raised.
Mr. Chair, when at the appropriate time, I have a few questions, not many, for Mr. Shaw.
Shoot.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Shaw, good to see you again tonight.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
We're on different sides of the aisle tonight, not like we usually are.
That's true.
So anyway, please, I've got to do this for the record. Have you ever done a convenience store with gas stations before?
Yes, we have.
How many have you done?
I would say over 40 of them.
Oh, I thought it would have been more than that, but that's a good number.
I don't have it at the tip, but I figured I'll go on a lower number.
And how many acres is this site?
You know what? I would defer that, unfortunately, to the civil engineer. I don't have that at the top of my head.
Okay, so you designed the building not knowing how many acres the site is?
We typically, the way we do this is we get the footprint from the civil engineer, taking into account the setbacks and what maximum we can get. And then what we work on the interior. So the site civil engineer typically determines the size of the footprint just to make sure that is within the allowable conforming ordinance.
Now you said you did at least 40 sites with convenience stores and gas stations. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And is it fair to say, based on your experience, that the size of this site is well below a typical site for a combined fueling operation and a convenience mart?
Again, that's a little bit beyond my expertise.
Did you read the report that was issued by Paul Phillips, September 18th, 2020?
I did.
Okay, and I'm going to I'll read you a line from his report, page 4, the fifth paragraph. It says, the intensity of the use on a site that is under 0.4 acres in size, well below what is typical for a combined gas fueling operation, with the associated convenience mart. Do you agree with him when he says that this is a site that is well below what is typical for this kind of operation?
Well, I defer this question to the experts who design sites, keeping in mind the restrictions and ordinances that they have to conform with. My expertise is within the building. And again, I would like to defer that question.
Okay, so you just design the site without any regard to how big it is then, do you? You just design it?
Well, we design it based on the size of the building that is designed and or determined by the civil engineer that they would feel that makes the most sense without really jeopardizing a lot of requirements.
Now, you earlier in your testimony said that this was a challenge to lay out this building. Is that a fair statement?
It is, because of the shape of the the site.
So you have the shape created some problems for you. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And is it fair to say that the size created problems for you?
I don't think the size created the problem.
Okay. Go ahead. I'm sorry. It was just the shape.
It was the shape. Typically, you work with a larger footprint and rectangle or regular shape.
Now, did you look at the history of this site?
Pretty broad question.
Okay, I'll rephrase it. Is it fair to say that this previous site was used just as a gas station?
I believe so.
And the previous use didn't have a convenience mart on the site, did it?
I would, knowing the way the condition is, yeah, I probably right, yes.
Okay. And so it's fair to say that the with respect to the convenience mart of 1,820 feet, as you testified to Mr. Steinberg, coupled with the gas station, that's an intensification of the use, isn't it?
Again, I would leave that question to the other experts.
You're just the architect, right?
I am just the architect.
Okay. You're not a planner then, are you?
I am not.
Okay. Now, you talked about it being in a flood zone. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And you said the building's going to be put on stilts. Is that correct?
That's correct.
How high are the stilts?
The building is basically flat and at in level with the front of the building, or front of the site, and then it slopes back. So the stilts are of a varying height.
You know, and excuse my ignorance. I'm just an ordinary layperson, but maybe I'll direct this even so Mr. Steinberg can listen, because I know Mr. Steinberg has a house at the shore. Is this going to be like one of those houses at the shore that are on stilts?
Not quite. The homes that you see by the shore, they're really on stilts. I mean, they are 9-10 feet above grade, and you'll step up to go to your first floor. In this case, it's just raised to flatten the first floor to make it accessible to the public that lines up with the parking area in the front.
So let me ask you this. Would there be enough room, and in picking up on Ms. Rosenthal's comments, would there be enough room for the disenfranchised and the homeless to sleep under this building at night?
Oh, absolutely. Well, I can't tell you what somebody would do, but I can't tell you yes or no to it.
But it's going to be bigger than 1 or 2 feet in terms of looking at it. You have room to crawl under there and sleep under there. Isn't that correct?
Well, as you can see on our elevations, we're showing an architectural feature that blocks the access. Like, you know, you have crossbars in the ring. It's an architectural grill that would deter people from going in. But, you know, I can't tell how people behave and what they would do. Not my call.
Okay. But you're talking about it stilts that would allow people to be under there. Isn't that correct?
If somebody wants to crawl under there, they can get there.
I understand. Mr. Chair, I have no further questions of this witness.
Is there anyone else who has any questions of this witness?
I would like to ask a question.
Yes.
Mr. Shaw, how far is the bathroom from the front door?
Oh, it's about 12 feet.
Is that typical in your experience?
Yeah, there's nothing unusual about the location of it, yeah, as far as I know.
Seemed atypical to me. Generally, when I go into a quick stop, the bathrooms are not that close to the front entry. So you're saying in the 40 plus that you've designed that they all seem to be about 12 feet away from the front door?
It all depends on the space that we have to work with. And it all depends on the layout, the way it would work. And we felt that this would be the best location considering how the space is, it could be laid out.
But would it be the best location if you had a larger site?
Not necessary. This would be, in my opinion, very convenient for, you would see in typical gas stations, you would see the bathrooms, not anymore, bathrooms on the exterior, or they're a lot of times they're in the front, but you go through the alleyway to get to it. Those are bigger stores. This is a small store. And that's why it's right in the front, which keeps the circulation easy and in front of the cashier.
But wouldn't a bathroom closer to the front door allow people to come in more easily just to use the bathroom and not purchase anything?
It's up to the operator how they want to use or let the public use the bathroom.
Thank you.
I have a question. Mr. Shaw, you indicated that you designed the building based on the footprint that the applicant's professional engineer provided to you, correct?
Correct.
When you refer to that footprint, are you talking about the footprint of the site, or are you talking about the footprint where the building could be located?
It's the size and the shape of the building.
Okay. So the professional engineer said you have this portion of the lot to design a building.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions of this witness?
I have one more question for my witness, for Jared.
Yes.
Thomas, just one last question for you. Although the prior non-conforming use was not a convenience store, we did have a service station with three bays in conjunction with the gas station, correct?
That's correct.
Thank you. No further questions.
I have two questions from attendees.
Okay.
Okay.
Is there an attendee asking a question now?
Oh, is it okay if I ask?
Judith Rosenthal, I think I brought over, yes.
Thank you for recognizing me. Sir, you mentioned that the site is in a flood zone. Did you also, as part of your architectural services, design the area for the buried underground gasoline storage tank?
No, I did not.
Okay, is there, Counselor, is there someone else that's gonna be addressing that issue?
Yeah, at a later date, I mean, at the next hearing.
Okay, just very quickly, did you have anything to do with designing any kind of system to prevent infiltration of floodwaters into the area around the underground gasoline storage tank?
No, I did not.
Okay, thank you.
And we had a question from another, comes up as O'Ann Rosenthal.
Really? Is she on that app?
Mrs. Rosenthal, you have to take yourself off mute. We can't hear you if you're asking your question.
Yeah, I don't know.
Mrs. Rosenthal, can you type your question in the Q&A section? Because we can't hear you.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, there you go, Ms. Rosenthal. We can hear you now.
Okay, thank you. When I saw the plans that came up on the screen, it showed a situation where there were more than three or four or five powder rooms, bathrooms in a row. Am I correct?
No.
What did I see? I saw something that looked like a kitchen where you could cook.
Well, on the interior.
Put those plans back up again so we can see them.
Can we please get your address, Ms. Rosenthal?
Pardon?
May we please get your address, Ms. Rosenthal?
My address?
Yes, please.
Your address.
Is Reeve Circle, number 25. I've been here 60 years in this home. And this is an invasion on a community that shall not be accepted. This is is a neighborhood, and you are putting something, you are tripling the size of what was there originally. And I can understand that it had to get a little bit larger in the years following when we moved in. But
Ms. Rosenthal, I'm going to interrupt you. I'm going to interrupt you. This is the chairman, Mr. Steinberg, speaking. This is not the time. This is not the time for you to give a speech. Ask a question of the witness,
all right,
please.
How, I want to know how many powder rooms he showed on those plans that were up on the screen.
There's a powder, you mean the bathroom?
Yes.
One.
It showed like there were more.
No, my plan shows only one.
Okay.
Mr. Shaw, could you put up SK3? I think Ms. Rosenthal is looking at the refrigerator doors because there are eight refrigerator doors.
That's
the bathroom.
Right here.
That's the right there is the bathroom.
Oh, okay.
Ms. Rosenthal, can you see up here?
Yes, I can.
Ms. Rowe?
Okay.
Those are the refrigerator doors.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you, Mr. Shaw.
Oh, you're welcome.
Are there any other questions for Mr. Shaw?
Mr. Steinberg, in the interest of clarifying for the people and the public, Ms. Rosenthal was, as you described it, giving a speech. Can you tell the public when the opportunity to give speeches will be?
Yes. When all the witnesses have been heard and have been cross-examined and the applicant has completed their presentation, the members of the public will have the opportunity to make statements.
Thank you, Mr. Steinberg and Mr. Posada. I didn't mean to be an officious intermeddler, but there, I wanted to make sure the public had an opportunity to know what the program was.
Always appreciated, Jack.
Thank you, Mr. Posada.
If I may, I'd like to call my next witness.
Please do.
I'd like to call my next witness, my landscape architect, Mr. Jack Carman.
Thank you, gentlemen, ladies.
Good evening.
Good evening. If you would just raise your right hand, please. Do you swear from the testimony you're about to give in tonight's Zoom hearing to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
Your name for the record, please.
Jack Carman, C-A-R-M-A-N. I'm a licensed landscape architect in the state of New Jersey.
Jack, can you provide a few boards that you have been qualified as a licensed expert in architectural landscaping? And then also,
yes,
whether your license is still in good standing?
I am currently a landscape architect for Bordentown Township and for Robbinsville, and I've testified before multiple planning boards, primarily in South Jersey.
And can you name a few?
Cherry Hill, Mantua, Harrison, Medford, Mount Laurel, as a few.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, do you accept them as an expert witness in landscape architecture?
His qualifications as a landscape architect are acceptable to the board.
Mr. Chair, just briefly, I missed it. What, I didn't get his name of his business and his address, and he probably said it, but I just missed it.
That's okay. I did not say it, but thank you. I am the director of landscape architecture for Spiesel Architects in Hamilton, New Jersey.
And the address?
The name of the company, please.
S-P-I-E-Z-L-E. Spiesel. And my address is 92 Tallawood Drive, Medford, New Jersey.
And Mr. Posada, I just want to make sure Mr. Carman is the fellow who submitted the plans that are on before the municipality.
No, he did not. Jack, can you please describe the history of the proposed plans?
Sure. Lauren Kovacs is a landscape architect. She's a licensed landscape architect. She had prepared the plans. She has since left the firm. So I am testifying as to the landscape architects for this evening's meeting.
Mr. Chair, I'm gonna let Mr. Posada do his thing, and I may ask some questions about the role of Mr. Carmen and his personal knowledge and that sort of thing. It might be more efficient unless you disagree.
That's fine.
Thank you.
Jack, first and foremost, was Lauren working under your supervision at Spiesel Architecture?
It predates me, but before Lauren left, we had reviewed the plans together in preparation. This was a couple months ago, knowing that it was coming before the zoning board.
And have you also had an opportunity to review the application, the related site plans and architectural plans?
I have, thank you.
Terrific. Can you please describe to the board the proposed architectural plans in connection with this application?
Sure, the landscape architectural plans. Would it be convenient if I shared the screen and brought the plan up?
Yes.
Okay.
That would be fine.
Okay. This is the landscape plan that's been prepared for the site for the convenience store and gas station. As a way of introducing the information that's shown on the plan, there are 9 new trees that are proposed, 104 shrubs, and 288 perennials and ornamental grasses. And the reason I identify it that way is that the site has been designed to reflect the residential character of the neighborhood. So as you can see, following the cursor, there are shade trees along the streetscape, buffer plantings along the perimeter, and a fairly heavily landscaped foundation planting around what would be, I guess, 4 sides of the convenience store building. And there's also landscaping around plantings around the sign on the intersection. So again, the plan reflects the residential character of the neighborhood. Right now, in looking at the pictures and so forth of the site, it's pretty well overgrown. So in my opinion, this would greatly enhance the character of the site and improve the overall aesthetics of the site.
Now you have a buffer near the Rahway River. Can you please describe the width of that buffer and what type of vegetation is used for the landscaping?
The plantings are a combination, the BN as shown here are Betula nigra, which are birch trees, shadblow. So they're more of a native tree, which might reflect the type of plantings you might find in a buffer or more native planting area. And then in addition, there are shrubs and perennials. And I don't have a scale to this because it's on the screen, but it would be anywhere between approximately 5 feet and at its widest point, over 20 feet. So it varies in width.
Now, with the plantings around the perimeter, would that help block the light spillage from the adjacent parcels?
It'll help. It will, yes, because the nature of the shade trees, the zelkovas have a vase shape habit to them, a V shape habit. So that in effect will help as they grow in, will help screen the property and buffer some of the lights. If you want, I can, give you a close-up of the number of plantings and an idea of the plant material that's involved in the site overall.
Can you run through those?
Sure. Again, 2 birch trees, 3 oak trees, 3 zelkova trees, and 1 shadblow, primarily. Those are the tree species. Then we have a number of evergreen shrubs, 51 Japanese holly, 3 inkberry, 2 Steed's holly, and 5 Virginia sweet spire. These are all evergreen in nature. And then deciduous shrubs, spice bush, rose, 39 of them actually, which will give a lot of color to the site, and three viburnum. And then the balance are perennials. I don't think you need me to give you the exact numbers, but we have plants that will attract nature, hummingbirds and butterflies into the planting beds, such as Coreopsis and Joe Pye weed. There are a lot of daylilies. There's actually 150 daylilies planted throughout the site. Cardinal flower, which attracts hummingbirds, Shasta daisies, which are in bloom right now. There are 55 liriope, which are kind of like a little spider plant. They're a low growing perennial that stay green through the winter. And then we have 9 maiden grass and 27 switchgrass, which if people are familiar with them, there was a comment or a question before about the shore. These are a lot of types of ornamental grasses you might find in a shore setting, but they're become very popular today. So they're used a lot, as well as screening and buffering and for color year round.
And were these species specifically picked to be more in conformance with the residential character of the neighborhood?
Very much so. You can specifically, the number of perennials that are located around the building definitely reflect a residential character to the building, to the site, and to the surrounding neighborhood.
And would this proposed landscaping increase the green space on the site from what's currently existing?
It will, yes.
Can you please describe a little more depth of what is existing today in comparison in terms of landscaping?
Right now, the site is overgrown. There's a fair amount, I don't know what percentage, but asphalt throughout. So this is definitely going to create a softer feel, look, aesthetic to the site, especially around the intersection.
So is it your intention with the proposed landscaping to break up that impervious coverage, most specifically with the perimeter landscaping and the landscape island?
Very much so, correct, yes.
Thank you. I have no further questions for this witness.
Are there any other questions from the audience?
First. Yeah, there is one question. If you'll just, as soon as he takes the screen down, I'll be able to. Okay, I have one question here, so we'll allow them to.
I have a question.
Okay, go ahead.
I'd like to know how long it would take for these plants to become mature.
The trees,
et cetera. I mean, it's going to take 15, 20 years.
Trees will grow on the average of 12 to 18 inches a year, maybe 2 feet. So they're going in at a substantial size, typically 2.5 caliber inches, which is, you don't want to plant a tree much larger than that. It takes longer for the tree to get established if it's too large, but this is a good planting size for the tree to get established. And zocovas are a very hardy tree. Rutgers has picked those out and identified those as trees that are very suitable for these conditions, for parking lots and so forth. So all conditions are right. The trees should mature. I don't think it's going to take 24 years for these trees to mature. I think
about how long do you think it would take before they start providing the amount of blocking of light and aesthetic, adding to the aesthetics of the property? I mean, it might be before, I mean, I'm 66 years old, so maybe by the time my children sell the house when I'm dead, they'll be matured or what?
I hope not. I think it's going to be a lot sooner than that. I'm 67 and I plan on the trees being mature within, say, 5 years or so.
Okay. Thank you for your answer.
Sure.
I didn't ask board members if they had questions of this witness. So let's go back and ask board members if they have questions first. Then we'll go back to the audience. Board members, anyone? Yes, Steve.
Yeah, I just want to, I'm sure this is something that we probably covered in a prior meeting, but I just wanted to mention it one more time. Normally in sites like this, at least from my perspective, the building, the convenience store, is on the other side of the gas pumps. So it's normally outer roadway, gas pumps, convenience store. We have it set up, you have it set up differently here. We have the convenience store first, then the gas pumps. Is that because of the floodplain issue principally?
I did not lay out the overall configuration of the site, so I'm not best suited to answer that question.
Okay, perhaps Mr. Posada can bring somebody up who can answer that for me. Thank you.
Sure. Any other board members? Any other board members? I have a question of the witness.
Sure.
Mr. Carmen, you're here tonight, so you heard testimony about the fact that the building is on, proposed building is on piers because of the water problem under the building and around the building. How does that water problem deal, or how do these plants that are proposed deal with the water problem?
It should not be an issue. And I think if something needed to be replaced, there will be a maintenance bond and so forth on it. So, you know, things could, if something did happen, the plant could be replaced, but they're well suited for the site.
And what type of plants are proposed for the area around the building itself, the proposed building?
Thank you. A lot of the plants that I've mentioned before, significant number of daylilies and native plantings, so cardinal flower, coreopsis, a mixture, and also, and that's perennials, but then also some evergreen shrubs, hollies, and plants like that.
Are those plants that can survive being submerged underwater?
Yes, not for any long duration. There aren't a lot of plants that will take that. Then you're talking about wetland species that would have to survive something like that. But these plants can take being submerged under a heavy rain for a short amount of time. When I say short, could be a couple hours, something like that.
Any other board members have questions?
I have one. Mr. Carmen, the plantings for either side of the driveways, will their height at maturity be low enough to avoid having an impact on the line of sight of vehicles exiting the property?
Yes, they will.
All right, counsel for the objector.
Thank you, Mr. Steinberg. And before I do that, I failed to do something at the outset of the meeting, and I'll look to Mr. Posada and Ms. Frazier and yourself. I am now taking over the case, so I want that in the record, and I should have said it right at the outset. A previous lawyer, Mr. Simon Havitt, and I'm now replacing him. So I want that in the record. I apologize for not doing that right at the outset.
And that's for the shopping center owner, correct?
It's the Millburn Mall, the same client he had. Thank you, Ms. Frazier. Yeah, but I should have said it at the outset, because in the past I've been the pinch hitter. Now I'm not in the bullpen anymore. I'm out here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, that being said, Mr. Carmen, how many times have you been to the site?
I have not.
I want to hear what you said. You have not been to the site?
I have not been to the site.
Okay. And you're familiar that this site is, there's going to be a proposed gas station. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And picking up on Mr. Steinberg's questioning, will these plants be able to withstand not only water, but water mixed with oil and gasoline?
No plants can really handle that, but I think, and I'd have to defer to an engineer to talk about that, but I think current DEP standards will protect the plantings as well as the site. If I'm correct, I'll ask you that.
Okay. And a member of the public named POPWO, we probably ought to get her name and address into the record.
Yes, I don't think she heard me ask for that.
So if she's still on the line, maybe you could recognize her so it gets into the record. But I have more questions, but I noticed she didn't get her name and address in the record.
Right, I'm bringing her over to John. Well, just to give us her name and address.
Hi, yes. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, I'm Bonnie Wofsy, W-O-F like Frank, S-Y, and it's 21 Reeves Circle.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
And I'm going to pick up on her questioning. You use the words as they grow in. What did you mean by that?
As they mature, as they become established, maybe I'm speaking in planting terms. I apologize. I want to be familiar. As the plantings become established, they get used to the soil and they set down roots and they take hold.
And I think you said in response to POPWO, her questioning, that it would take about 5 years for the plants to mature.
Sure. It's a question, right. It's a definition of what do you mean by maturity? How large? So for these plants to grow in and become larger shade trees, the first year or so, they start to get established. But after that, they're going to put on again, maybe 12, 18 inches of growth a year.
My concern with that is that normally the warranties for trees are only 1 or 2 years. How long are the warranties going to be for the growth here?
That's something that's not, that's a good question. I don't think that it's regulated by the township ordinances.
So what could happen is, in response to POPWO's question, if it's going to take 5 years for them to grow, but if they die within 3 years, let's say, we may be in a situation where we have a big hole here with no growth.
I think that's that would be a discussion with the township.
I have no further questions.
Any other questions from either the board or from the audience of this witness?
I do have, I have three people who have their hands raised. I will bring over, I think Ms. Ropsey. Do you have a question?
I don't have another question right now.
You don't?
I was top Wofsy, so we're the same people.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. I have Ms. Rosenthal, who has a question.
Hi, Mr. Carman. How are you?
Good evening. Fine. How are you?
Okay. You mentioned that the trees along Millburn Avenue are deciduous. And for those people in the audience who don't know what deciduous means, would you please explain that term?
Sure. They lose their leaves in the wintertime, in the fall.
So that means that basically between late October and late March, there won't be any leaves on the trees to block the light for residents who live across the street on Millburn Avenue. Isn't that correct?
To some extent, you still have the branches of the trees. So it's not like it's an evergreen tree, but yes, they do lose their leaves.
Right. So they would be staring at basically the light would filter through the bare branches, right?
It depends. I guess it's hard to say. I don't know where the homes are, you know, in relation to the trees.
And that's because you've never been to the site, right?
That's correct.
Okay. Now, you also mentioned that, let me go back to this. When you brought up the landscape plan, I think it showed some topographic lines.
Do you want, I'll ask the chair, do you want me to bring that plan back up again?
Well, let me just ask you, is the site going to be regraded?
There is grading involved. I didn't work on that. I'd have to defer that question to the civil engineer.
I understand, but for purposes of landscape planning, you need to know where the water's flowing, right?
That's true.
Okay. And right now, the water flows towards the stream, right?
I did not work on the grading plan.
Well, in order to start, I mean, you need to have seen what the original topography of the land is, right?
Not necessarily, because it's all being reconfigured to suit the current conditions.
Okay. Is there any grading towards this stream, which is immediately adjacent to this property?
I'd have to go back and review the grading plan. It wasn't exactly, it's not what we had to do for the landscape plan.
Can you do that right now?
I can't. I don't have the civil plan with me.
I thought I saw topographic lines on the map that you brought up.
It's up to the chair if you want me to pull that plan up.
Fine, please pull it up.
Sure.
Okay, now I might be wrong, but I see lines that look like topographic lines, 95, 94.
Correct.
Okay. So it looks like as there is an area of land that is lower as you get towards the stream. I see a 94 on that area by the proposed birch trees.
The 94 contour, correct?
Right. So at least in that area, water is going to flow from the parking lot into the landscaped area, correct?
There's a curb around the landscaped areas. So again, I would defer to the engineer as to where the inlets are located.
Okay, but as a landscape architect, you need to understand where the water is going in order to not only decide, in order to decide what kind of trees are going to be planted there and what their tolerances are for water and salt. I mean, the lot's gonna have to be salted, right, in the wintertime?
I can't speak to that. I'm not operating the site.
As a landscape architect for a commercial property, you're telling me, and you want members of the board to believe, that in designing your landscape plan, you did not even think about salt and its impact on the plants that you propose for this site?
I'm sorry, I can't speak to that. I don't
Why
know.
Why not? You're an expert. You're a landscape expert. All right, I'll move on. I think you've kind of answered that. What is the mean high water mark for this area?
I do not know that.
Okay, but you do recognize it's in a flood zone?
Yes, I do.
Okay. As a landscape architect, I don't know the answer to this. Do you have to comply with any DEP regulations in connection with the type of buffer plants that you put within the flood zone?
What we prefer to use would be more native plants, which is what you see or what I had shown on the planting plan. So yes, the industry has been moving to introduce more native plantings within, because for a multitude of reasons. A, they're better suited, they become more established easily. They're hardier plants, they're indigenous to the area. Again, I've mentioned before, they will attract wildlife in the form of birds and butterflies and bees, so pollinators. So we look at the plantings holistically, A, that it's suited to the area, that it's indigenous, that it should survive, that it's hardy. So again, you know, back to your question of the salt, most plants do not tolerate. Some may tolerate a little bit better, but Zocovas as an example. Again, I mentioned Rutgers and the studies that they're suited to parking lots. So the plantings that we've picked out for this particular site have been looked at from a variety of perspectives.
But in answer to my question, are there any DEP regulations regarding the buffer zone that applies to commercial properties immediately adjacent to streams? I used to work way back when for the DEP, Bureau of Stream Encroachment, which is why I'm asking this.
There are recommended species, yes.
Okay, and the plan that you developed, is it compliant with the DEP regulations?
As much as I know, yes.
You kind of hedged there. What do you mean, as much as you know? I mean, this is your job. You were hired to do it. You should know.
It was, as was mentioned earlier, the plan was developed by Lauren Kovacs, who also was an employee of Spiesel, who has left the firm. And we had reviewed the plan together. And I am now taking over for her.
All right. No further questions. Thank you, sir.
Sure.
Any other questions for this witness?
Yes, there is someone else. Ms. Rosenthal, do you have a...
How much higher will the new canopy be compared to the present canopy?
I think I'll have to let the architect or civil engineer answer that question.
Any other questions? Any other questions for the landscape architect? I hear no other questions. Next witness.
Thank you.
Counsel.
I have no further witnesses for tonight. As a professional courtesy, Mr. Delaney advised that his planner, Peter Steck, would not be available for tonight. So as such, we have agreed to postpone to the next hearing date, at which time we will be providing, I believe, both our planners and then hopefully our summations as well. I believe that the tentative date was November 16th. Mr. Delaney, have you had an opportunity to speak to Mr. Steck to see if November 16th will work for his schedule?
Yes, I have, and he's available.
Terrific. If that's still available for us, we would humbly request to be carried.
Mr. Posada, you have agreed to an extension of time to the end of this month. We now need an extension of time, I think, safely to the end of the year.
Yes, we'll provide
that. Prepared to
through the end until December 31st of 2020 for a decision of this application.
Are you saying that you agree to that on behalf of your client?
Yes.
Okay, so I think what you're saying is both of your planners will be available on November 16th.
Correct.
Yes, Ms. Fraser, yes.
Okay. Eileen, is that the date we can put them on the agenda?
Yeah, I spoke to Mr. Posada today, and I did indicate that was a date that I have no applications currently scheduled. So I had pretty much set it aside for them.
Okay.
That's fine.
So Mr. Chairman, I guess now is appropriate for either you or I to make an announcement for all the members of the public who are here in the audience that this matter is being carried to the board's meeting on November 16th at 7 p.m., which will be a Zoom meeting, correct?
Yes,
correct.
It'll be again a Zoom meeting. The information will be available on the township website, and this is being carried without the need for any further notice.
The only thing I would ask, Mr. Posada, I didn't see anything submitted on the website. Is Mr. McDonough, your planner going to do a report or not?
At this time, I do not know, but he will be providing a report. I'll see to it that he submits it 10 days prior to the hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Posada. Thank you, Ms. Frazier, on that.
Yeah, any documents that anybody plans on submitting on the 16th have to be provided to Eileen in advance so they can be placed on the website. She would need PDF versions. And you'll have to find out from her how far in advance she actually needs them. But if you can provide them 10 days before, that would be great.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Frazier.
Mr. Posada, will you provide Ms. Davitt with a written consent to an extension of time through December 31st tomorrow?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And Ms. Frazier and Mr. Posada, in the interest of completion, could I be copied on that extension too?
I wouldn't have it any other way, Jack.
I have another hand raised from Ms. Rosenthal. Do you want to take a question?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, hold on one second.
Thank you again. I don't know if you folks have read about this in the news, but California has enacted a law to ban the sale of gas cars by 2035. One in four cars in the United States is sold to a Californian, which means that California drives the market. If California is going to ban gas cars by 2035, the rest of the nation will follow suit. Why am I bringing this up? Because in 15 years, gasoline stations will largely be obsolete. So if you allow this development to go through, you have to ask yourself as Millburnites, what are we going to be looking at in 15 years?
I'm going to interrupt you. This is the chairman speaking. You're making a statement that would be appropriate at the end of this case.
Well, you said that the members of the public could speak at the end of the meeting.
No. At the end of the hearing.
I'm very sorry. I understand. Thank you for explaining that to me. And I'll make my remarks at the end of the hearing. Thank you for your serving on this board.
Mr. Cherif, and this goes to Mr. Posada and Ms. Frazier. And also Ms. Davitt, what do we anticipate the program to be on the 16th? I presume it's going to be just Mr. McDonough, then it'll be Mr. Steck, my witness, and would we, and I don't know your program, whether we'd hear them and have the public speak or what, so I look to the, respectfully, either the chair or legal counsel or Ms. Davitt on that.
I concur with what you proposed, Jay, that I would be having Mr. McDonough provide his testimony followed suit by Mr. Steck. I believe that'll be open for the public, then followed by our summations, unless I'm incorrect with that presumption. I apologize.
And I don't want to be presumptuous with the chair. Do you anticipate a full program that night in completing the case, or what would you like, Mr. Chair, respectfully?
Well, we're hoping to complete the case that night.
I understand.
Which means we'll hear whatever witnesses the parties wish to present. And we'll hear then statements from the public and statements from counsel.
And I'm not opposed to going out to 2035 when there'll be no cars if you want that. So I'm not opposed to that.
And could I just remind any members of the board who have not listened to any of the prior hearings, Ms. McNett obviously never made it in tonight, and I know that because she sent me a text, she was having difficulty joining. If you would all please be able to listen to any hearings that you missed so you're all eligible to vote and can provide Eileen with certification. Thank you.
Is certification in the form of an email sufficient, or is there a form?
I'll send you the form.
Thank you.
There's a form. And Eileen will make the form available to you, Steve. Right, I think that we had only this one application on the agenda tonight. Is that correct, Eileen?
Yes.
All right. Is there a motion to adjourn at this point?
Ms. Craig.
So moved.
Okay. Craig Pletner moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Jody Sharma seconded it. All in favor?
Aye.
Say aye.
Aye.
There must be a football game on or something.
Probably.
Have a good night, guys.
Okay, thank you, everybody. We'll talk, Matt. We'll talk before the meeting, and we'll see you on the 16th.
That's great. Thank you.
Terrific.
Eileen.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye bye now.
Is there no meeting on Wednesday?
There's no meeting on the 21st.
There's
no meeting on the 21st.
Special meeting on the 28th,
right? That's a planning board meeting.
I got the meeting for the 28th.
Yes.
And the 28th.
Okay.
Good night, everyone.
Good night. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, everybody.
Good night.
Leave the meeting.